because this is a pretty serious film. Obviously, we're talking about the loss of life of United States service members, so God bless them all, and thank you for your service. Welcome back, everybody. Clint here today with Classic Firearms, here today to talk about another Top Guns from a movie. Today's movie that we are hitting on is Lone Survivor. I'll go into a little bit more detail about what the movie is about, but first, I've got some important information I need to tell you guys. Some of the content and trademarks we are going to show you in this video are not ours, and this is not sponsored by any other company. We are not affiliated with Universal Studios in any other way. We just wanted to take a deep dive into the firearms they used in the filming of Lone Survivor. So with that being said, Lone Survivor is a film about the actual Operation Red Wings that took place in June of 2005, where four Navy SEALs were caught up in a firefight while trying to locate, capture, or kill a terrorist by the name of Ahmad Shah. With that being said, a series of unfortunate events took place, and having read the book and seen the interviews, Lone Survivor is about the one survivor of that mission. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and talk about some of the guns from this movie. Number five, the AK-47. The enemy combatants, which are seen throughout the whole film because, well, it's Navy SEALs in Afghanistan in 2005, you're going to see Taliban. And one of their weapons of choice is the AK-47. And throughout the movie, you see different variations of the AK. You see the underfolders, both for the AKM and the AK-47. We all know and love this system, chambered in 7.62x39. Ultra reliable. These things shoot great. They feel great to shoot. And, well, it makes sense. Well, and they're also pretty inexpensive to make, depending on where you're at. If you're in the United States, you're gonna make a high-end AK, it's pretty easy to spend $2,000 on one. But with that being said, again, just ultimately fantastic rifles, and it makes sense as to why, well, they're so popular, especially in Afghanistan, because apparently, you know, superpowers just leave all of their weaponry and armament there. And, well, when Russia pulled out, they left all their AKs. When America pulled out, left all their M16s. And you just see the transition of terrorist organization going from one system to the next. It's kind of funny, don't you think? Anyway, let's go ahead and move to my number four pick. The next one, the PKM. Talk about just an awesome machine gun. First of all, it's a belt-fed 7.62x54R chambered machine gun. So, yes, absolutely, I would take one. Also, it's designed by Mikhail Kalashnikov, so you know it's got all of his good genes stone in that. Gas-operated, open-bolt design, just, it's just awesome. Definitely on my my top 10 list of all the guns that I've ever wanted. But anyway, with that being said, in the movie, you see the enemy combatants go ahead and start to set this guy up, right when the main character of the movie, Marcus Luttrell, says, "Hey, I think his left is good, that machine gun opens fire," and completely negating the fact that he said the left is good. The true fact of the matter is now that it is not good. And you start to see them try to flank and do everything they possibly can to get out of that machine gun fire. It also shows, too, just the lethality and the effectiveness of belt-fed machine guns and why they're so widely used. And, well, if they're used effectively, you can see that in the United States and throughout everywhere else that might have some sort of standing army or not. So there you have it, the PKM, fantastic machine gun on my list for the top guns of Lone Survivor. Number three on my list is the rifle or the weapon systems that Mike Murphy and Danny Dietz are using throughout the movie, and that is the M4A1 with the M203 attachment. So, of course, it is the M4 that we all know and love with the grenade launcher attachment, and we see these guys running with the ACOGs just doing absolute work throughout the movie with this setup. At one point in time, too, we do see Mike Murphy turn the gun sideways as it looks like he's trying to sight in and maintain a low profile while engaging the enemy with an M203 40mm grenade launcher. So send in the hate with that one, that's for sure. But anyway, really cool system. The only bad thing about having the M203 attachment is, of course, the weight. And when I think about these guys are trekking through the woods for miles and long distance and all that type of stuff, obviously you gotta be in good shape, have great endurance. Well, to carry all the weight that you're carrying, all the supplies and gear that you need, all the munitions that you need, and all the weapons you need, including this grenade launcher, which again adds weight. And well, kudos to those guys for being able to do that. And I guarantee you that in that situation, they much rather have it than not have it, kind of like firearm ownership to begin with. But anyway, with that being said, the M4A1 that you see here that's set up for Danny Dietz, he also has the vertical grip attachment just below the grenade launcher. And you kind of see that on all the different weapon systems that the SEALs are running. One way or another, they have a different type of attachment. They all kind of ran however they liked. Whatever they thought would be best for the mission is how they're going to set up their gear and set up their weapons. So it's pretty cool to kind of see all of that in play there. And of course, the real life Marcus Luttrell was on set during the movie to give instruction and also say, you know, hey, this is how we did it. This isn't how we did it. Yes, we had our gear set up. No, we didn't. So he's pretty cool to have all of that firsthand experience right on set and see all that play into the movie. And you definitely see that in the design, the paint schemes, all that on the weapon systems. So with that being said, let's go ahead and move on to my next pick. My number two pick, because this is a pretty serious film, obviously we're talking about the loss of life of United States service members. So God bless them all and thank you for your service. For my number two pick, I figured I'd relieve this a little bit and go with a cop out. I'm talking about the AC-130, the attack cargo 130 gunship for that close air support, ground attack role that it has is freaking amazing. This thing just unleashes all sorts of firepower, and whatever it's in its way will have wished it wasn't in its way. First of all, it's got a 25 millimeter Gatling gun made by General Dynamics on it, the GAU. That thing is, well, 25 millimeter just isn't small when you think about it, and is laying down a serious rate of fire, and well, it's over. And it's already bad enough for that if you're a bad guy. So let's just say you do have some pretty good cover. Well, they got a Bofors 40 millimeter cannon on top of that as well that's in the gunship, which has been around since like the 1930s as an anti-aircraft gun. Well, now they turned it into a pro-aircraft gun and made it anti-ground. And again, just, it's pretty awesome. And let's just say that still didn't finish the job. The 105 millimeter howitzer, the M102 that's on there also, that'll probably finish the job. The entire job of the AC-130, since all the guns are just on one side of the plane, is just to circle the entire area of operations and just lay down as much firepower as possible on the enemy combatants' cover and positions. Well, that does a really good job at what I was talking about a machine gun does before as far as suppressing fire. Well, imagine 25 millimeter auto cannons and 40 millimeter Bofors and 105 millimeter howitzers raining down on you. That's gonna be a pretty good job at suppression as well. And of course we see that towards the end of the movie, all of this firepower unleashed from the AC-130. I think this one was the Spooky. But yeah, the AC-130 Spooky is just, it's a force to be reckoned with. And of course I was gonna talk about it here. I know it's not exactly, you know, a small arms by any means here, but I figured since it did play a pretty important part in the movie as far as getting Marcus Luttrell out of that area, yeah, it's also a really cool scene. Needed to have it in there. And for the honorable mention, I do want to talk about actually a pretty emotional scene because we see this pistol used a couple of times throughout the movie, but in this situation, the Beretta M9 is drawn and emptied by Axe just before, spoiler alert, losing his life in this scene. But you see him going down with a fight, absolutely, until he's expended all rounds from his Mark 12 that he had and also to his M9. Now, before that as well, again, if you're not familiar with Operation Red Wings, you're not familiar with what all took place over that period of time, the M9 is also seen drawn on a pilot, the pilot to the aircraft bringing the relief, bringing the Navy SEALs, telling them to land, but the area was too hot, and that was a different situation there. So you do see the M9 a couple of times throughout the movie, and we all know the M9 pretty well by Beretta. It's 9mm chambered, has been a standard issue service pistol for a long time now, and it's actually one that I've got a lot of experience with myself. Even bought an M9A3 because I really liked it, and they're actually really good guns. I know there were some issues with like the locking block, something like that being an issue, being like breaking over a period of time, but we also found out too that they weren't really being maintained all that well in the armory, so that may have had something to do with that. Anyway, let's go ahead and move on to that number one. My top pick for the guns of Lone Survivor isn't the RPG. I know I kind of cheated with the AC-130. The RPG is definitely seen all throughout the movie, but it's actually the Mark 12. That axe and Marcus Luttrell are carrying around with them. Now you'll notice too that there are different variations of the Mark 12. The original Mark 12 motto had the PRI rail system on it and was not a quad rail like what you see in the movie, which is the Mark 12 Mod 1, which is closer to being similar to what we're currently giving away, the Daniel Defense Mark 12. However, the one that's seen in the movie is also using the Knights Armament Rail Adapter System, the RAS, as I simply like to call it. So you'll see the ring where it locks up to the upper receiver. Very cool system. They are using the Leupold scopes. They're also using the Harris bipods. So all of that that you see in the movie is correct to what would have actually been used at that time, which is also pretty cool. And on top of that, you'll also notice the silencer that Marcus Luttrell is using is actually wrapped in twine. That was something that he actually liked to do. Offers a little bit more camouflage, breaks up the I guess you could say the smooth edges of the silencer, because in nature, nothing's really smooth and it kind of sticks out. So again, they would be painting them up like you saw and everything else. So the Mark 12 is pretty cool. Now, of course, they do have, when it comes to these types of missions, it really is up to that operator, what he wants to carry and everything else. So you would probably see, like Marcus Luttrell's Mark 12, he's running around with a fixed stock, kind of like an A2 stock on an M16. As where Axe's Mark 12, he's running around with an adjustable SOP mod stock. So again, very much so like the one that we are currently giving away. And did the Mark 12 that we're currently giving away inspire the idea behind this video? Yeah, of course it did, right? I saw this and I was like, dude, I've been a big fan of the SPR, the Special Purpose Rifle Mark 12, for a long time. I've always just liked the looks of it, thought it was really cool how the gas block just ended right outside of the rail. And on the original ones too, they had the Allen Engineering type of brake and also locking system for that silencer. So the silencer would actually act as a shroud over the barrel. It's not the shoulder thing that goes up, and it would actually connect back here. So you'd have very little barrel actually exposed that wasn't under the rail or under the silencer, which is pretty cool. So all of those escaping gases have all sorts of areas to travel, which did do a little bit better for flash and sound suppression, which again, I just think it's pretty neat. And it just looks very unique. Whenever you see a Mark 12 upper, it's very easily identifiable. Now, the Daniel Defense Mark 12 that we have right here, it's kind of their take on the Mark 12. Of course, I've got my Mark 12, we call it the Mach 12, pretty much close to, again, their take on it. Now, what we've done with this is we've teamed up with Alex Zedra in this giveaway. If you haven't seen that video announcing it as our giveaway, go check that out. But for fun, we did decide to go ahead and throw on the Surefire brake on here. It is a two-chamber brake, very, very flat shooting gun. It's a very fun gun to shoot. It's chambered in 5.56. It's just a lot of fun. What more can I say? So, but it is also their QD host for their silencers. So if you did want to pop a can on it, feel free to do so. And of course it does have their M4 quad rail on it. So this is more of their rail interface system. So it locks up to the upper receiver using the nuts that you see right here going around. So it screws into it. So it's a very tight locking system. It'll hold zero if you wanted to throw on any type of laser, IR, stuff like that. Harris bipod also on this guy here. And don't need to pull, just need to drop. And there's that for you. Coming back a little bit further, we do have the Trigicon 2.5 to 12.5 power second focal plane optic. And it does have a little viewer here for some fiber optic on it. So if you actually wanted, and it does have like illuminated center dot on this. So if you wanted, you can turn that guy completely off if you're getting too much of a dot exposure that's taking up too much of the target, or open it all the way up if you're in some real low light settings and you need to be able to see your reticle, which I think is pretty cool. Also, American Defense Manufacturing QD mount for the scope and bipod, and a T-Rex Arms 45 degree offset for the Trigicon RMR that we included on this. One thing that I do like about this gun, it is actually pretty lightweight even with everything on it. And if you needed to engage at distance, you can, but if you wanted to engage a little bit closer up, very easy to rotate the gun 45 degrees and get your red dot on target. Pretty sweet if you ask me. Also too, does come with Daniel Defense's charging handle. Very nice, 32 round mag, because Daniel Defense said, why the heck not? Does come standard also with the Geissele two-stage trigger. Big fan of that. Their grip, and also too, we decided to throw on the B5 system SOP mod stock because again, I really like the look and feel. It just has a really cool aesthetic to it. So that's what we went for on this guy here. So head on over to classicfirearms.com to get your entries in for the Danny Defense Mark 12 and just hit that top banner. It'll show you all the different ways to gain your entries. And one of you guys pointed out down in the comment section that Alex may have suggested using code word sausage just because I have to say it in every video, but it was actually Ryan who's behind the camera. It's like, well, she was waving around that sausage at me when I was not making up excuses. I was giving valid reasons as to why I did not do so well in our competition, but she was waving a sausage in my face. So yeah, with code word sausage, that'll get you a couple hundred extra entries on that guy. Let me know what you guys think about the movie. Let me know down in the comments too, what are some of the guns that you may have seen? I did also see a Makarov at one point in there, so that's always fun. Who doesn't love a Makarov, right? There's all sorts of other different weapon systems in that movie, so let me know what you think down in the comments below, and I'll leave it off there. Guys, as always, we appreciate you and your business. God bless, and again, God bless all of those service members out there too that have lost their lives in order to keep our freedoms. We appreciate you guys. We'll see you next time at classicfirearms.com.